What are your thoughts on like evangelistic tools, like tracts or surveys? Like, how would you guide somebody in that, whether they should use them or not? How effective have you seen them in the past? Mm-hmm. What should we keep in mind if we're going to use some of those tools? Let's talk about some evangelistic tools here for a second.
I don't have a problem with tools, but I do think tools need to be revised and revisited.
Okay.
And so sometimes you look at the tools and they're really cheesy. Mm. And we don't want to come off with a sort of cheesy-anity. We got enough of that, Lord knows.
Right, right.
So I think when it comes to a survey, for example, there was a season when I was doing campus ministry when I was younger. If I went out now, people would be like, what's this old man doing walking around on a college campus? But when I was younger, I created a survey that asked questions. And I found that that was really helpful because it wasn't threatening. So before I created the survey, I just walk up cold turkey and ask people if I could chat with them. But once I created the survey, I could walk up and say, hey, Tim, how you doing? I'm out conducting a survey. I'm trying to get 100 of these done this week. Mm. And I just was wondering if you would participate. There's no, fear and how to answer. I'm not here to beat you up. And then I would come up with like five questions. You know, do you think that God exists? What do you think about the person of Jesus? Do you have a relationship with him? Do you think he can make a difference in people's life? If you don't believe, why not? Something like that, right? Yeah. So you ask those questions. Everybody likes to be a part of a survey.
Yeah.
Well, that's not true. Everybody doesn't like to be a part of a survey, but most people like to be a part of a survey. And what I found then is after they answer those questions, well, guess what? I can begin to engage because I just found out their worldview.
Right.
I found out their worldview in about five questions. So I think surveys do have a place. Mm-hmm. I think that we need to let people know that we're not there to beat them up. Some people get so passionate, they just ridicule people, and they really don't help our witness for the church. I think that tracts can serve a place. For example, if you're meeting somebody and you don't have a lot of time to chat, you could give them one. Joe Gibbs, the wonderful coach. He's one of the most well-known coaches of all time, Hall of Fame coach. He used to go to a church that I pastored. But for a long time, I kept bumping into him at Starbucks and different places. And every time I bump into him, he'd hand me a track. It was creative because it was his face on the front and it was kind of his story and he kind of led it to Jesus. And eventually I was like, Coach, I'm stacking these up, bro. I didn't call him bro, but I said, I've got a lot of these tracks. Well, that became this big joke once he became part of the church and I was his pastor.
Yeah.
But I just want to say there is a place for this stuff. If you're going to make a track, though, make it presentable.
Yeah.
Make it look good. Use good language. You avoid Christianese. If you're going to use a survey, there's a place for that. When it comes to methodologies, there's lots of different methodologies, but we must remember that there's lots of different methodologies. Not one of them is something you're going to find in the Bible.
Yeah.
So I think different tools can help us. In the same way with apologetics, we talk about, are you a presuppositionalist or a classical apologist,
right,
or
evidentialist,
these different types, or a combinationalist.
Yeah.
I think that you can look at those and there's different approaches that can help you given where you are.